another 8 after here. It's all right. Okay. All right. It's my great pleasure to welcome Professor Manuel Lafarga Marquez, Penelope Sanz, Jorge Camarero, and Rosa Cortez Calvo, who are here from the Call of the People, who were shown in this painting. And you'll see there's quite a crowd. And one of these includes the Spanish composer Diego Ortiz, who was for a music theorist and chapel master of the Viceroy of Naples. Naples was for a time under Spanish rule. And also the Venetian painter Giorgione and Veronese himself. So we're going to learn a lot about the painting, about their project and their website. He's brought with some publications that are most downloadable online. And we have, thanks to Edgar, who is a student in our musicology program and speaks fluent Spanish, his native language. And he will be here to translate if you have any questions to ask of them, of our visitors. And of course, I hope you do. So please welcome the team from Valencia.
Thank you very much. When I prepare some text, it's better than exposed to you to my catastrophic English. And later, he helped us. Good morning. First time, many thanks to Professor Barbara Hack Puglo and to the University of Maryland, College Park, and equally to the audience for paying attention to our work. The possibility to introduce the most renowned European violagambist during the Cinquecento. When I prepare some text, it's better than exposed to you to my catastrophic English. And later, he helped us. Good morning. First time, many thanks to Professor Barbara Hack Puglo and to the University of Maryland, College Park, and equally to the audience for paying attention to our work. The possibility to introduce the most renowned European violagambist during the Cinquecento to an expert audience, and especially inside the American academic circles, is a true pleasure for us. Especially in Maryland, the land of Mary, who gives the meaning to the great Veronese's canvas while asking her son for new wine at the biblical wedding, though her open, although empty, left hand. Despite the efforts of renowned scholars, so little was known about Diego Ortiz until very recently that it could be summarized in a couple of paragraphs. Born on an uncertain date, perhaps in Toledo, since the demonim Toledano was synonymous in Italian lands with Spanish, because this was the imperial capital. We have news of him for the first time in Rome due to the publication of his first book in December 1553, The Treatise of Glosses. The book is dedicated to Pedro de Urries, but in the probable case of having arrived earlier in Neapolitan lands, he would have first served Pedro de Toledo, viceroy from 1532 to 1552, and died in Florence the following year, 10 months before the edition of the treatise. His name, Ortiz, appears a few years later in a 1558 payroll of the Neapolitan court of the House of Alba, and 7 years later, in 1565, Musicus Liber Primus, his second known work, was published in Venice. His death was supposed to have occurred in 1570 because his succession as Maestro de Capilla of the Royal Chapel of Naples by Francisco Jiménez de Loscos. A recent work, however, Valerio Morucci, 2018, places him in Rome for 6 years after his presumed death in 1570. Until at least 1576. The term viola da gamba is mentioned in the Cinquecento for the first time in two readings from 1511, the German treatise by Sebastian Verdun and the Ippolito d'Este Catalogue of Instruments. The first treatise dedicated to the solo practice was that of Silvestro Ganassi dal Fontego, this published in Venice in 1542, which was followed by that of Ortiz in Rome 11 years later. These are the only two treatises dedicated to the instrument during the 16th century. Ganassi insisted on the opposite opinion to Diego, preventing to hold the viola horizontally in the Moorish manner, as they are depicted in Veronese's Wedding at Cana. The book was published in two versions, Spanish and Italian, by the brothers Valerio and Luis Dorico, the editors for the Vatican. It seems that Ortiz was also a clergyman, as clarified in the papal privilege of his own treatise, and alike that he had arrived as a man of arms in the company of other Spanish musicians to the surroundings of the Neapolitan court of Pedro de Toledo. The Viceroy of Naples signs 1532, died on February 12, 1553, while Ortiz's first book was published in Rome 10 months later, on December 10, dedicated to Pedro de Urries. Some sources suggest that Ortiz became known as a viola instructor in the environment of this nobleman of Aragonese origin. Political and cultural heritage of the Aragonese monarchy had brought the Royal Chapel of Naples to very high levels of quality, and the city itself to the cultural and artistic vanguard of Europe. Naples was the most populated city of the Spanish Empire, only surpassed in Europe by Paris. Unfortunately, there is a historical gap in its archives from 1495, the end of the Aragonese era, to the end of the 16th century, and the first known documents on music at the Vicereal Court date from 1648. However, we know that the Royal Chapel was moved from Castelnuovo to the new adjacent Vicereal headquarters by Pedro de Toledo in 1540, and that it was refounded again in 1555, in the time of Viceroy Pedro Pacheco. Diego conducted this new formation at least from then until 1570, and probably also the previous one, since he was already chapel master in December 1553, when the treatise was published. In 2003, the names of two active musicians in the Ortiz Chapel were reported. One, a soprano singer named Michele Garcia, and the other, an organist named Fabrizio Gaetano, or Gaetano di Cesa, who had apparently arrived just as Ortiz, as a man of arms, at the time of the original nucleus of the musical chapel of the Royal Palace, SEC. The Spanish musician signed the dedication of his treatise in Naples to Pedro de Urries, a renowned protector of the arts, judging by the author's own words. The figure of this nobleman of Aragonese origin has so far received little attention, also in relation to the life of Ortiz, due to the extreme scarcity of data, added to the presumption that he had died in Sicily in combat in 1519. Already in 1727, one of his descendants, Ruiz de Castilla y Urries, had questioned his early death by providing a notarial document from 1555. 2 years earlier, according to parish records, his son Hugo had been named Lord of Ayerbe in case he could be died in the service of the emperor in the war against France, SEC. The document proves that he was alive in 1553. Pedro de Urries obtained the barony of Pirano 2 years later, in 1555, and requested permission from the authorities to exploit the mines he owned in Sicily. Finally, he was still alive in 1559, but outside Aragon, as deduced from a document from his wife. while 2 years later, in 1561, he must have died, given that the new heir to the barony was already his son. The blind Spanish organist Francisco de Salinas maintained close contact with Ortiz for years. He had previously been in Rome since 1538, also coinciding there with Cristóbal de Morales, and later joined the Neapolitan Musical Chapel of Ortiz as organist until 1558, shortly before returning to Spain. Salinas must have been in Naples before 1553, as we have also suggested for Ortiz, given that, as Diego's future successor, Francisco Jiménez de los Cos, informs us, they were both singers in the musical chapel of Pedro de Toledo. The next news about Ortiz places him again in the Royal Chapel of Naples 5 years after the edition of the treatise. His name appears in the collection of letters and documents gathered in 1891 by the Duchess of Alba, where he is mentioned again with the position of chapelmaster, heading a list of musicians' salaries in February 1558. Diego signed his own salary and also in his name that of Francisco de Salinas, the organist, and those of 12 musicians, mainly singers, while that of the organist Fabrizio Gaetato, presumably in the Royal Chapel, since 1555 with Ortiz, does not appear. Francisco Jiménez de los Cos, who would later be his successor in 1570, appears in fourth place. Even today, some sources cite this date for his admission to the Neapolitan court as chapel master, and also that of 1556, attributing this circumstance to the viceroy Fernando Álvarez de Toledo. However, the acting viceroy at this time, both mistakes were already pointed out by Robert Stevenson many years ago. However, the acting viceroy at this time was his son, Fadrique Álvarez de Toledo. And Robert James Borrowdale correctly mentions the year 1558 and reproduced the original document verbatim in his doctoral thesis of 1952. As we have already pointed out, it is certain that Ortiz was in Naples at least since 1553, given that the dedication of the treatise is signed there. The papal sanction identified him as chapel master of the viceregal court of the city, SEC. This happened 2 years before the old chapel of Pedro de Toledo was refounded again by Pedro Pacheco in 1555. Apart from this document, Ortiz's trace is lost again until the publication of his second book 7 years later in Venice in 1565. However, a recent happy discovery, Alejandro, one of us, is not here present, places him in the same city also a couple of years earlier, in 1563 at San Giorgio Maggiore. It is possible that Diego Ortiz came from, or at least participated in, the viola orchestra of the court of Ferrante de Aragon, viceroy of Valencia, one of the most renowned ensembles along the mid-Cinquecento. At its peak, coinciding with the death of the viceroy in 1550, the musical chapel consisted of 42 singers, 21 instrumentalists, 3 organists, 2 copists, and 1 dance teacher. The orchestra was left in charge of his second wife, Mencia de Mendoza, although without funds, and its musicians finally dispersed around 1553, the same year in which Ortiz published in December his treatise in Rome. The oldest preserved viola da gamba was depicted in the Cathedral of Valencia on 1472 by Francesco Pagano and Paolo de San Leocadio, two painters who came from Rome in the service of the bishop of the diocese, Rodrigo de Borgia, the future Pope Alexander VI. The instrument clearly shows the frets and five strings. We may appreciate the magnificent Renaissance cupola of the cathedral with 12 musician angels. It is admitted that the viola da gamba has its origin in the Spanish bowed vihuela, and that it is spread throughout Europe from the Aragonese, Catalan, or Valencian courts. It was our colleague Javier Alejandro Casillas who first identified Diego Ortiz 10 years before our meeting in 2017. Next to the Malaga Cathedral, he informed us about the probable identity of the unknown musicians who whispered his diminutions in the left ear of Veronese. He also informed us his own unsuccessful attempts till that moment to convince any art specialists who properly considered his proposal, an enterprise that we undertook and completed, in our opinion, successfully, and that has generated by now more than a dozen works devoted to these topics. 10 of them are already published, one in press. I will show you at the end of the class. The engraving is also the only known portrait of one of the most important and famous European violagambists at the moment of publication of the treatise, 10 years before the termination of the wedding. His facial features are quite unusual. Though individually or in some combination, they could be present in many other characters, it is unlikely they all appear together at time in two different famous violagambists separated by 10 years. It is also unlikely that other specialized coeval musicians could coincide in so many traits. We think that the general shape and aspect of the face and hair of both portraits show a surprising similarity, which is supported by 12 specific features. 1. Shape of the high style. 2. High tight, short and curly. 3. Shape and density of the beard. 4. Shape of the receding high line at the forehead. 5. Form of the high line plus one wrinkle at the temple. 6. Three longitudinal wrinkles in the forehead. 7. Three wrinkles in the corner of the eye. 8. Prolonged pocket below the eye. 9. General shape, contour and size of the nose. 10. Shape of the ala and alar furrow of the nose. 11. Shape of the ear and its relative size, and 12. Proportions of facial traits and general overall appearance. The Musicer Liber Primus is dedicated to Don Pedro Afán de Rivera, who was officially designated Viceroy and successor of Pedro de Toledo after more than 6 years and 7 prelates and generals as interim viceroys. The book contains sacred polyphony in a compendium of 69 vocal pieces in 4, 5, 6, and 7 voices, and was published in Venice in 1565 by the printer Antonio Gardano, just over a year after the delivery of the Veronese's canvas. In the dedication, the author identifies himself still in Naples and expresses his desire to write a book of masses, a work of which there is no information and which probably did not reach the printing. The title suggests that he planned a second part for this work, perhaps the book of masses. The monumental canvas of the wedding at Cana was the result of a commission from the Benedictine Order of San Giorgio Maggiore and was intended to preside over the refectory for meals, raised 2 meters from the ground by way of trompe l'oeil. However, the commission turned in a very tiring enterprise on a very frequented scaffold. Among all the transformation, the author was compelled to mutate the nature and arrangement of the central musical ensemble up to 4 times, perhaps 5. As it can be observed from the radiographies of the canvas obtained in 1989. Some of these images were published by Louvre Museum 3 years later, in 1992, by Lola Failand-Dumas. This is the current appearance of the canvas after the restoration, from which, combined with the X-rays published by the Louvre Museum, we have deduced and reconstructed most of our graphic observations and also the identity of almost all the guests at the Benedictine's biblical banquet, which represents the first miracle of Jesus Christ according to John's Gospel. This is the central musical ensemble, the current one, and this is the X-ray images published by the Louvre Museum. In 1992, and I make disappear the canvas. And this is the publication of Lola Failand-Dumas. There are only 2 publications apart from us on this topic. The identity of the Spanish musician has remained hidden until our first work in 2018, even without allusion in literary sources, where it has been repeatedly omitted. His portrait at the canvas had confused scholars for 250 years, since Sanetti the Younger wrongly attributed his identity to Tintoretto, in turn omitting the mention of its true owner, the violinist. We believe to have shown, however, that the original proposal of his relative Zanetti the Elder, Anton Maria Zanetti, they are both related, Anton Maria Zanetti the older and the younger, the elder attributed it to the violinist was the correct. Therefore, it necessarily came from a legend based on the real context of the canvas during its creation. His facial features compared Tintoretto's facial features, compared to his self-portrait at the age of 54, still exhibited today in the Sala Grande of the Scuola di San Rocco, seem much more coherent with the character depicted on the canvas. Another one of Javier Alejano's findings is that the initial notations of the score behind Veronese's head, Ortiz's score, could be reproducing the anonymous tenor of La Spagna, one of the main melodies used by Ortiz in his own treatise. The first 4 notes seem coincide with this term, except for the 3rd one, located a lower tone. This circumstance would indicate a coincidence close to 70% between both designs, the tenor and our proposal. The 4 signs that precede the notes indicate the bass clef in fourth line, the scope of register of the instrument, viola bastarda, I'll show you later, a flat on the B tone, F major tonality, and the time signature, respectively. According to Marco Boschini, the Venetian painted musicians identified themselves on the canvas by a gold ring on their left hand. The exception to this rule is Titian, the contrabass, who displayed a second ring on his right thumb, according to our model, in memory of the missing master of the canvas under Ortiz's portrait, Giorgio de Castelfranco, also called Giorgione. The only character in the group who does not wear a ring is precisely Ortiz, who was not a painter. His left hand is the geometric center of a circle that encompasses all of them. We have also proposed that the literary inscription written in the skull under Titian's hand here is only coherent for Veronese's gaze direction, given the orientation of the spellings. This. This expression could be indicating both the origin of the egregious new guest and the name of one of the themes he chose to elaborate his famous treatise, the same one we are postulating for the score that Ortiz should look at. We believe that the inscription could be literally interpreted as Spania, as can still be observed on the current canvas here. We improved this image and with filters and other things. The current scores, preventing future askings, are not readable. The two tenor violas look like similar instruments, but they are not. Ortiz is slightly larger and lower in tune, with 7 strings, 5 frets, and a wider and visibly shorter neck, which barely advances over the body of the instrument. The width of the soundboard is also greater, while the Veronese's viola has the same number of frets and only 6 strings. And its visibly longer neck, with no frets, moves towards the center of the case. We believe that the Ortiz's instrument is a melodic bass viola with an additional string tuned in A, sometimes called viola bastarda or viola division, quoted by Don Randell, 1997. And that the differences between both instruments, we believe that these differences are due to the presence of the Neapolitan maestro. Thus, this is the oldest representation of this instrumental design. The 4 treatises that allude to its size in the first half of Seicento describe it as intermediate between the tenor and the bass. The bastarda technique, applied to 4 parts polyphony, allowed the creation, improvisation, of interweaving of a 5th voice, parts or discanto, crossing all the registers of the remaining 4, a form of virtuosity that reveals a very high technical training, only attributable to the Neapolitan maestro in the ensemble visible in the current canvas. The majority of violists were also lute players, so they abstracted the chordal style to create the discanto voice, concentrating their invention and imagination on the different registers and on the motifs that they felt were important, or those which best suited to their hand or instrument in each moment. It is evident that the 2 violas are not equal nor real instruments, because it has since they have no notches, and the execution with a bow is therefore almost impracticable, or at least limited, even more evidently for the virtuoso, that is Ortiz. The same can be said of the chords depicted on the 2 necks, The positions, in a technical sense, are correct, but it cannot be stated that they represent a specific cause beyond our own argumentation, nor can be related to the score observable in the canvas. I said just a moment. The chords, but above all the shape of both instruments, could just be the consequence of the graphic needs of Veronese. To observe the fingering of the two tenors, we have considered firstly, and in both cases, the tuning that Ortiz offers for the tenor register in his own book, and also seven other treatises until the second half of Seicento. This was the standard tuning for this instrument in both Italy and England, from the upper lowest to the highest string, covering a total of two octaves. Ortiz's Viola Bastarda has in fact a seventh string tuned in A, as pointed to by Don Randell, 1997. In an acoustical sense, the positions of the fingers press tempered notes on an open string, as occurs in the current romantic instruments of our modern orchestra. Thus, taking in account the contemporary treatises, the combined observation of both chords seems to point to the key of A major. The first detailed study dedicated to musical patronage in 16th century Rome, recently published by Valerio Morucci of the University of Nevada, Reno, has brought to light new documents from the Vatican secret archives, which show that Ortiz did not die in Naples in 1570, when he was succeeded as Maestro de Capilla at the Royal Chapel by the Aragonese Francisco Martinez de Loscos. The evidence indicates that he apparently moved to Rome to serve the Colonna family as a familiare, perhaps with the consent of his master, Pedafán Enríquez de Rivera, who died 1 year after Diego left his position. His contract ended on June 12, 1570, but it is possible that he remained in Naples until Pedafán's death on April 2, 1571. The first documented payroll in Rome is from 1572. The patriarch of the Colonna family at this moment was Marco Antonio Colonna II, third Duke and first Prince of Paliano, Constable of Naples, Viceroy of Sicily, and Captain General of the Papal Navy. The documents established several monthlies for 4 years, between 1572 and 1576. Then his death must be reconsidered later to this date. It is possible that his new position at the Roman court was similar to that in Neapolitan court, or perhaps he served as instructor for members of the family environment, as we postulate for him in the Veronese painting, or even in a position more in line with their merits and age. The title familiare was given to those professionals who, in addition to their salary as contracted artists, in Ortiz's case, a regular one pre-established by contract, were under the protection of the family as members of the house they represented. This is the first one of our next two presentations at the 16th Century Studies Conference in Baltimore. It is devoted to the funeral San Mass for Giorgio de Castelfranco, named Giorgione, as his loved Venetian citizen right. It will be introduced on Friday, 27th, 11 and 10 a.m., Renaissance Baltimore Harbor Place Hotel, as part of Depicting Ceremonies 3, Italy, table, conducted by Jennifer Mara da Silva. Well, this is the abstract of the of this first presentation, one in my chat, and one by me myself, and the second one by Penelope Sanz and Jorge Camarero. This is devoted just to the original funeral sang mass. Sure. We are showing the first concert recreation. It means the original funeral sang mass for Giorgione as his pending Venetian citizen right. Tintoretto and Titian were not in their current location, but singing together with two monks, probably two Cantadori di Morti, the funeral mass that Giorgione could not have because of his premature death at Lazzaretto. Because an unknown reason, Veronese was forced to dismantle this typical Venetian musical ensemble for funeral rites, and his own inverted harpsichord silhouette generated, this is his silhouette, inverted, generated the figure of Titian in its current location. Giorgione is there. Giorgione attended his own posthumous tribute, impassive and silent, holding his legendary lute. On Friday in Baltimore, the details of this original formation will be introduced for the first time to the academic community and the international public. We are showing the approximate character silhouette which occupied the place of Ortiz in the former design, on top of Giorgione's self-portrait, inverted, now at Herzog Anton Ulrich Museum in Brunswick. This is, according to Giorgio Vasari, this picture was displayed at Grimani's art gallery in Venice in the times of the Benedictines Commission. As it was the case with Ortiz, we think that the general shape and aspect of the face and hair of both portraits show a surprising similarity, which is supported by a similar number of specific features. The facial features which we consider as concurrent are: one, markedly curved profile of the nose. Two, size and proportion of the nose. Three, little mouth with thin lips. Four, left descending corner of the mouth. Five, probable position due to different angles, shape and size of the eyebrows. Six, similar marked eye sockets. Seven, wrinkle that descends from the left lacrimal. Eight, shape of the chin. Nine, receding hairline with a right angle over the temple. 10, global contour of the face. 11, global contour of the hair. And 12, global aspect of the hair. There is only one mention for the presence of Giorgione in the canvas, the protagonist of the central scene as designed by Veronese in origin. One century after the commission, Jean-Baptiste Colbert, minister of the King of France, visited the monastery in 1671. Few years later, he left us a testimony which has been part of the legend till the addition of our own works. According to the Venetian monks, Giorgio da Castelfranco was also present at Canvas. This is the second one of our next two presentations at the 16th Century Studies Conference in Baltimore. It is devoted to the three intermediate instrumental consorts in between the original funeral sang mass and the current canvas with Diego Ortiz. It will be introduced on Saturday, 28, 10:50 a.m., Renaissance Baltimore Harbor Place Hotel, as part of Artists Lives and Work Table, conducted by Luba Friedman. This is the abstract. And we are showing, we are going to show you the fourth concert artistic recreation following our graphic designs after Veronese by Jorge Camarero. This was the first ensemble which included brass instruments. It means the last instrumental formation prior to the late arrival of Diego Ortiz to San Giorgio Maggiore at the end of summer of 1563, probably heading towards the conclusion of the Council of Trent. Giorgione's second violin is our conjecture, since this was the ultimate violin position for him to finally cover Veronese's head when the author of the canvas was a harpsichordist. The monk who sustained the score during the original mass holded a trombone, which finally disappeared behind the current cornetist. The Turkish who hides his face appeared alike at this moment with the U-shaped trumpet to conceal Veronese's back contour in the previous ensemble. All these are our publications to the present day. The first one is devoted to Diego Ortiz, which
it's
already announced. Don't worry, because near all, more than this, are freedom law at our webpage. I show you later. The first one, devoted to Diego Ortiz, which already announced Giorgione's presence in the canvas. The second one, with our presentation at the 2019 Lucca International Conference, Luigi Boccherini Foundation, until I am Fenlon chairman. A third, this one, an historical tale relating the avatars of the canvas in a literary style. And this is a brief review of the state of the art till that moment. The two central covers down show the conformation of second concert, lutes, and how Paolo II Frankenstein was generated from other previous cartoons, and the first group of characters which we think have, identified following Holt's, Henry Frederick Holt's legend and our own observations. Some coeval artists, patrons, and ecclesiastics. The other two, this one, are devoted to Diego Ortiz, having been published by Musica et Figura. Third row shows our last and very recent edition, don't worry, devoted to the legends on the canvas and also those related to Giorgione. This, the reconstruction of the hidden trumpet behind Veronese, the fourth preserved source of the medieval precedent for trumpets, the U-shaped trumpet. The arrangement of the first concert, as we have introduced here, and finally, the mutation to the two successive violin bands, the third and fourth concert, as they will be introduced by my two partners, Penelope Sanz and Jorge Camarero, in the conference. All publications, four of them bilingual, are directly accessible at our internet address, except the two papers, which are the property of Musica et Figura, the musicology magazine of University of Padua, where many of our guests studied and sojourned for a while. In addition, we are pleased to introduce here a new research type, to introduce here a new research line emerged from the right side of Paolo Cagliari, the Etruscan devil of Manierism, as Stefano Zuffi referred to him. One of the three only survival sources of the U-shaped trumpet around 1400 is coincident with the U-shaped trumpet behind the author of the canvas. This is the trumpet. This is the hidden trumpet, and this is the reconstruction. During the next four plates, we will show our three reconstructions for these instruments, which were physically inexistent previously to our work. They were introduced at Castellón de la Plana in a brief cycle of two conferences by the authors and the responsibles of the reconstructions, Vicente Campos and Luis Escribano. The first one, similar to that depicted in Veronese's back, appears in Charles de Noble's Book of Hours, folio 106, and it is the property of Cleveland Museum of Art. Charles III was called the Noble for his qualities in diplomacy, a role that he frequently played as a young man before the French court, in representation of his father. It seems that he was a lover of books, of which he kept a good number in the library of his palace in Olite, Navarra, Spain. Charles did not commission his book. He probably acquired it on a trip to Paris in 1404 or 1405. A similar book of hours in the British Library, probably from the same bookseller, keep the spaces for the coat of arms in blank, awaiting for a potential buyer. His own coat of arms of Charles the Noble appears in more than 20 pages, in each one of the miniatures that occupy half a page and once a full page. The artist responsible for the planning and decoration, author of 17 of the largest miniatures, came from Bologna, and is known as Master of Capitals of Brussels. His main assistant, a Florentine who signed his name Zecco, on the verso of folio 208, was in charge of most of the borders surrounding the images. These margins are profusely illustrated with grotesques, many of them paradoxical or meaningless, and others with references to popular or well-known characters of their time, including animals and chimeras, hybrid of animal-human, animal-animal, or animal-plant. Up to 104 of these figures are reading or doing something in relation to books, and more than 180 represent musical instruments, thus making it this book of hours that contains the most musical iconographical sources. Both trumpets in the Book of Hours are similar in design, unlike that of the Paduan Bibler, whose bell is shorter than the main tube, the next trumpet. The trumpet in D, the previous one, emits seven partials on the fundamental, D4, and the chimera that holds it in the miniature is a hybrid of bird and human. The trumpet in E flat emits six passages on the fundamental E flat 4. And the chimera that holds it in the miniature looks like a hybrid of dog and human. The Paduan Bible is a richly illuminated manuscript commissioned perhaps by Francesco Novello and was produced around 1400 by a team of scribes and artists, probably led by the painter Jacopo da Verona, whose workshop was sponsored by the powerful family Carraresi of Padua. It is a visual discourse in the style of the square vignettes of modern comics, very elaborate in terms of details. These include, in addition to facial features, beards and hair of numerous characters, drawings of animals, interiors, landscapes and buildings, and warlike and violent scenes, endowed with a spatial sense that gives them a real and three-dimensional appearance. The Paduan Bible is the only illuminated, illustrated Bible that survives from the Italian Gothic. The work has been divided in two fragments since the 16th century. One is in the Accademia dei Concordi in Rovigo, and another in the British Library, the one that concerns us here. The two oldest direct representations of a luthery workshops for trumpets are that of Johann Christoph Weigel the Older in 1698, and the one that appears in the French Encyclopedia edited by Diderot and D'Alembert in 1765. However, we believe that the oldest is that which appears on the same plate before the third source we are dealing with, the U-shaped trumpet of the Paduan Bible. This trumpet is a different specimen from those of Charles the Noble, since the length of the bell tube is clearly shorter than the main tube, less than half, inversely to the other two previous trumpets. This is the type of medieval U-shaped trumpet that seems to fit the instrumental prototype that the Litus represented for the Etruscans and perhaps also for the Romans. Its sound is much more penetrating and open, strident, also due to the larger opening of the bell and the progressive conicity of the entire tube, as was the case with the Roman Etruscan Litus. And the difficulty in emitting is considerably greater than the two previous trumpets. This type was probably intended for military calls or to call and or announce civic acts, celebrations, or similar events, since the triad can barely be reached in its third octave register. Two opus which allowed to perform in these trumpets have been commissioned for its premiere at Castellón de la Plana, Spain, on February 2024. This is the place where I worked the past year, and I come back to Castellón next year. That's the life. From left to the right, at the end of this presentation, Manuel Lafarga, Luis Escribano, de Luthier, Penelope Sanz, Jorge Camarero, and Vicente Campos, who is the trumpet player. To conclude, the plate shows our complete team, and you may ask your guests with your questions in a moment. Oh, excuse me. To the right, out of the scene, the two painter lutenists, Jorge Camarero and Giorgio da Castelfranco, two excellent Baroque violin professors, Ángel San Pedro and Teresa Casanova for the recreation of third and fourth concert, two sculpture professors, as Tintoretto and Titian, Natividad Navalón and Teresa Schaffer, two famous Pifari professors, wind players, Vicente Givera as jester, and Vicente Campos as the current cornetist, the finder of Diego Ortiz, Javier Alejano, while whispering his diminutions, to the speaker's ears, Penelope Sanz as Andrea Schiavone, and up to the left, the skillful luthier Luis Escribano. He and Vicente Campos have reconstructed the design of the U-shaped trumpet behind Veronese. There are just three miniatures of this type of instrument, previously inexistent, physically inexistent to our works. Thank you very much for the service, your attention. And please, you can make your questions. Okay. Oh, Barbara.
Edgar is going to translate. So first of all, I'd like to open if any of the students in the class have questions.
Just a minute, please. I forgot to show the web.
Oh,
if you connect or later at the end.
Oh,
in five minutes, I may show you. I can show you. Or web page.
Okay, so you need to unconnect
this.
Disconnect
that and okay.
There.
At this web page, www.theweddingatcana.org, you may download six publications, richly illustrated and richly detailed with bibliography, and we didn't leave at this time. What we just did is to read what others write.
I have a question while I'm setting this up, which I think is important because other people might not know. It seems that there are different layers of painting in the Wedding of Cana. Can you tell us the history? How many layers are there and what are their dates?
Of course. I can have most wonders in the profesora Haig pregunta sobre las diferentes
five.
Okay.
Cinque.
Okay. y como la historia detrás de esas cómo decir diferentes
well,
capas.
Yeah, I try to explain quickly. First one is the typical Venetian concert. This is a typical Venetian funeral sung mass for each Venetian citizen. The city pay you, even if you have no money, pay you when you're there, one sang mass. However, John died from peste at Lazaretto, in the common diet. Then, this is the first formation, the first layer, with clavecin, two cantadori di morti, and Titian and Tintoretto completing the vocal quartet. The second one, for any reason, was a lute consort. I may show you if you have some manners, but I don't know.
No, Mike.
I may show you quick. The second layer is a lute consort. The harpsichord disappeared. The vocal quartet was dismantled, dispersed. And for this next mutation, yes, there is a historical reason. Lute ensemble still was a funeral reed, this is true. However, at the time of the canvas, it had unfashion. All the confraternities of Venice during the three earlier decades were changing his instrumental ensembles for the funeral rites, actualizing lutes, changing lutes for violin bands. There are two violin bands, the original mass, the first lyre, the lute consort, the second lyre, the third consort or first violin band, the fourth consort or second violin band, and the current one when, with the ortiz and violas da gamba.
Okay.
So, if you want to come up here and
go ahead. Yeah, I TA in the next classroom, so it should be
okay. Perfect. Yeah,
why not? But if we
did you understand my catastrophic English? Really?
Yeah, actually, sometimes it's beneficial.
It's beneficial?
Beneficial, because it makes the listener pay attention.
Beneficial means good.
Yeah.
It's good.
Okay. I understand. And when I pronounce Spanish names, I pronounce really good. Yeah, it's a joke.
I'm interested in this idea of like musical iconography. And I just wanted to learn more about your background and their background as, because you're doing two types of work, like you're an art historian, but you're also a musicologist and music historian. So what is your background? Are you primarily a musicologist or more art historian, or kind of live in both worlds?
Okay. My formation is a musician. I played au bois many years ago, 3 decades ago. I studied 5 years of piano, and I teach history and aesthetic of music from 25 years ago at universities or conservatories in Spain. However, I am doctor in art by Polytechnic University of Valencia. And in the case of Jorge, Penelope is music teacher, education graduate, master in technology, educative. I don't know to say it right. You understand?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And he is the co-author of many of his publications. And Jorge and Rosa. Jorge is composer, and Rosa is a brilliant pianist. Yes. And they both studied with me some years ago. And Jorge paints. Well, perhaps not like Veronese, but near. And he spent his time in my classes painting.
He's got it.
But attending.
Yeah.
And I saw what he is capable to do. And when I find him some years later, when I had finally understood what happened with the 5 lyres, and I asked him, and I said to him, I cannot pay you, but this is the glory. When you die, you have the glory. Sure. If you want to participate, and he said yes. And by this reason, we both are here with you. Is this? Oh, okay. This is the, Anita, may I connect this? I'm not skillful. Well, I try.
Sure.
I try. Okay.
No,
es por moverme con facilidad.
Okay.
Pero voy a intentar. Well, this is our webpage, designed by Penelope Sanz. And I show you how how download easily all the publication, except the two of Musica et Figura
published.
Well, these are some publications. If we press here, it's the same. You press here, the PDF, download PDF, and you discharge automatically. Visually illustrated. This is the first one. Well, the first one, this is the second one at Lucca International Conference. I am Fenlon, was the chairman. Now he's a good friend of us, and we are really happy. But I show you better to this other. Well, here you have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and the legends, which is the legends, is still in. I show you where. If you press, wait a minute. If you press here, and you have different.
Topics.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. This is the second, the lute band. I show you in a moment, very quickly, the 5 consort, and it's all. Excuse me. This is the first publication devoted to Ortiz by my press, and this is in a digital format, but also you can download very easily. This is the second concert, Lutz. This was still a funeral mass atmosphere, musical atmosphere, in the decades earlier to the conclusion of the canvas. But this type of ensemble was old fashioned. This is documented by Glickson, Jonathan Glickson.
Oh, yeah.
Venice and the Hidden Enemies is documented. And this is Tintoretto e Grimani, Alessandro Vittoria, the first of our proposal for 8 new characters. I told you before at the beginnings, we know the identity of near all the guests of the banquet except 4 persons. However, we are not to tell at conference who they are. This is our treasure, our work, and we are going to to give in this present to academic community, few by few, step by step. There are many people there, and it's again a story of conflict with Venetian pro-reformer Venetian prelates who looks for the peace with Protestants. There are no Romans, there are no Catholic authorities. Huh. All they are Venetians. And some of them were processed and some were died. But this is the future of this terrific story, and we are going without pause at this same webpage. It's 6 months, 3, 4 months. In Christmas, in January, there will be a new publication. And in 6 months, by the way, we don't know where this enterprise will bring us. But we are working for not to bury Giorgione for the 2nd time. This cannot be happen again. And this is, if you move on this persianas. Persianas. Well, come, how do you say?
This thing?
Yeah.
Yeah, just like click on that. Was like in the
and if you are in this same where we were, you have here 3 and 5, mm-hmm. one more in January, and the legends, que no las veo, pero están por ahí. Okay. Okay. I show you, okay. Thanks, Penelope. I go to the main page. Yes, she makes the web page. She knows more than I. And this is the thing I'm telling you. This is the second concert, Lutz. Yeah. This is the last, the recent one, the legend, both for canvas and Giorgio de Castelfranco. This is the tale in a literary style, really easy to read. This is the Lucas presentation. All are free download. And this is the first one. This is the 8, 9 guests, the second youth concert, the legends, and well, this is the question. If you want see the concert quickly, I show you.
Concert? No? Yes, I would like to.
Okay, then I need this.
Okay.
Okay, thank you.
Of course,
thank
you.
Apart of our presentations, there is one more in 2 days at this same university.
Yes, in the art history department.
Yeah.
I'll send out another notice about it. They have a more beautiful poster.
It's a different approach. This was centered on Ortiz's life, mm-hmm. and something we'll show it again For example, the U-shaped trumpets at the end, but it's different. Okay, I show you. And I don't want to forget to say this. For all we, the four, it's a true pleasure, as I told at the beginnings, to give an expert and attento audience. This is unusual in Spain. That's the truth. And Gongora said, as the truth is, what is the amargo?
It's not sour, bitter.
Bitter. I want the spell of the mouth. Sí, ya sé dónde está. Ok, pero ahora no veo yo aquí. No veo nada.
Ah, pues ponlo duplicado.
Duplicado,
claro. I have many help to do this.
Also, do you know if when
my mother is so
proud. When Diego Ortiz was in Venice, did he know Vicentino? Nicola Vicentino.
Well, I know the papal the conclave in the plaza of the Vatican between Vicentino and Lusitano, Nicola Vicentino and Vicente Lusitano, was I think you remember was the year of the treatise publication, 1553 or 1555, uh-huh. And the canvas is 1562-1563. In 15 months, Veronese must change the arrangement on the councils. 1 year prior to the canvas, he has failed. And in the canvas, he lost his hair. Mm. Yes. Then I show you this consort, the artistic recreation mm-hmm. by Jorge Camarero, following my own designs, following Veronese's designs, visible in the X-Rise images. Giorgione. It has some in common, but in a different presentation. And I may show you in a moment. Okay. Okay. This is the center of the scene, including Veronese's brother, Benedetto Cagliari. However, at the first moment, in the first concert, the miraculous wine did not exist because the current left arm with the wine was the left arm of Veronese when played lutes. I show you the first concert by Jorge Camarero. In fact, Benedetto was painting a previous modelo of the wedding. This artifact introduces infinite mathematical recurrence because it includes the whole canvas inside the canvas. But we have some ideas, but not a convincing hypothesis, why Veronese must compel to dismantle this console. This arm, in fact, is the bigger room. Is the only arm in all the canvas that fits in this position for this specific function. The bright room actual current is not. There are two weddings. There are two alliances. Well, this is a big meccano with cartoons. Cartoons are silhouettes of arms, torsos. It's like a puzzle. But never Veronese confused the contours. All time reconvert the global contours, include one in never. he was really the Etruscan devil of Manierismo, Stefano Zuffi. Well, this is the first consort. I show you the second.
Yeah.
The lute ensemble.
Is the keyboard correct? Is everything about the keyboard?
Harpsichord? Is there?
Yeah.
Is not all this is not so visible in the cameras.
Yeah, right.
However, in the X-ray, excuse me, in the X-ray images, but we many times reconstructed the pieces, las piezas,
mm-hmm.
That we need, and many times later we found them.
Mm-hmm.
It's a big meccano, with all my respect, you know. Puzzle. Well, Veronese didn't paint Veronese, the family, the Bottega of Veronese, had five or six good painters. They paint like him. This is the way to work at these times for these big productions. Of course, not for one portrait, but in this 70 square meters, there are many painters. There are different levels of painters. The best.
Yeah. Where was the painting kept originally? Was it in a private palace or?
What painting?
This painting.
This painting is in front of the Mona Lisa in the Louvre.
I know, but it wasn't always in the Louvre. Where was it in Italy?
Bueno, the painting was at San Giorgio Maggiore in Venice.
Oh, right, yes, you said that.
Until Napoleon's troops brought to France.
Was it in a room or in the church?
In the refectory.
In the refectory,
yeah.
Okay.
2 meters under the floor, like a trompe l'oeil. I said at the beginning, but sure I pronounced catastrophic. Well, I show you the second one, Lutz, by Jorge Camarero. There are both versions of Lutz, because there was an intermediate consort in between the funeral mass and the lute consort. This art is impossible. It's duplicated. Mm-hmm. This is not the true. This is the fifth proof, perhaps, but it's some more complex, and I leave this moment. But I show you the true Lutz consort is this. With this position, this is the current left hand to viola of Berenice. In this lower position, Benedetto hold the new miraculous wine. I may show you in a better definition. And you may appreciate how skillful is our painter musician Jorge Camarero. This is the second Veronese's lute. At this moment, of course, Benedetto Candiani has the wine. I show you the first of the two violin bands by Jorge Camarero. And at this moment, Giorgione assumed an active attitude. Till this moment, he was silent because he was deaf. But with violin bands, Giorgione assumed his first violin. They are not brass instruments at this moment, and I show you the fourth concert, the second violin band by Jorge Camarero.
By who?
By you. You may
so
see here.
What is the large vial, but the instrument right next to it that looks older, not the violin, between the trombone and the large vial?
May you tell me?
Sí, well, there's a problem on the instrumento que está medio. This one, right? Like right next to the big one?
Yeah.
¿Cuál?
Este instrumento que esta persona está sosteniendo.
¿Cuál? The trombone, the sacabuts?
No.
This violin?
It looks, it's not a violin. It looks like an older instrument.
This? No.
Creo que es.
Tell me what. Press this.
This one, right?
This one is Tintoretto's violin, soprano violin.
Okay.
In the third, this is the fourth.
Okay.
In the third, the position is on the neck.